Hi everyone, super excited to be here to talk about what we're all here to do, which is really bring about the next billion users into crypto. So without further ado, it's an awesome privilege to have everyone here on this panel today. My name is Chia from Patera Capital, helped to cover all the kind of consumer infra investments at Pantera. We've got an amazing selection of folks here today to talk about what they're building. Maybe starting from this order, could you please give us a quick introduction of yourself and brief few sentences of your background, what you're building, and how you decided to land on this problem that you're solving today?
Sure. My name is Oleg Fomenko. I'm co-founder of Sweat Coin and now Sweat Economy. I've presented earlier. We basically started in 2014 thinking that we will be on blockchain, but could only move in 2022. And we are making the world more physically active. We allow you to earn sweat simply by walking. So the problem we solve is making the world physically active and bringing tens of millions of users into Web3, because we already have 15 million token holders and 5 million sweat wallet downloads on Near. So, you know, kind of we're really, really excited to be part of this ecosystem.
Hi, everyone. My name is Chris Gale. I'm the co-founder of an NFT marketplace called Few and Far. We've been building on Near over the past 12 months. And what we really see with our background, we've worked a lot with Fortune 500 companies in previous businesses, and making NFTs, making Web3 more accessible for the mass market is a key problem that we're solving. And thanks to a lot of Near's great technology and onboarding solutions, we're able to do that very, very seamlessly and efficiently. And then we also have an infrastructure side of our business, which we're providing API and NFT tools for great projects to build and scale NFTs on Near.
Hi, I'm Hugo. I'm CEO of PlayAmber. So we're a mobile game studio with over 100 million downloads. And about a year ago, we started making the move to Web3, and we've created some infrastructure, so a Unity to Near SDK. You can basically plug it in with a few minutes and turn a Web2 game into a Web3 Lite experience.
And I'm Daryl Fannin, CEO of Kino. We are a company that is decentralizing film and television and giving you access to behind the scenes, and that you can be a part of movies that you'll love. I've created some TV shows with Matt Damon, his arch nemesis Jimmy Kimmel, and I'm very fortunate to have access to some really incredible creators, and we're going to be launching movies this year.
Awesome. So I think I'm super excited because the speakers here today have a lot of experience bringing just users in the Web2 space, reaching the mainstream audience, and so really excited to see what we can learn today. So maybe we'll start off with Chris. You know, what are some of the problems that you see in the NFT ecosystem at the moment, and how do you think about how growth is going to emerge over the next few months and years and decades?
Sure, yeah, great question. We've heard this a lot today on a number of talks and panels that just Web3 is very, very hard for new users and the masses to get on board. You've got the whole figuring out a third-party wallet extension, like a MetaMask, how to then fund that MetaMask, how to send crypto to bridge, to change chains. It's very, very complex, and we often use an interesting analogy of then, you know, if your mom can do it, if your parents can't do it, then you're not going to get the masses on. And so we really believe that solving that and making a seamless onboarding and user experience to come on board and then start trading digital collectibles, minting NFTs, is a really great way to onboard the masses. And that's the one big area on the UI UX. The second is an interesting and very new trend at the moment that we have a problem with in the NFT market, and that's royalties. And it was a problem that started back in September time, which where we identified and started trying to solve, which was the ability for NFT marketplaces to control the business logic of these NFT contracts. So if we look at OpenSea, we look at Magic Eden, when they designed the marketplace mechanism, they kept the business logic in the marketplace, which is very anti-Web3 ethos. And so the analogy is you're trusting a If you had a store and you had a cash register, imagine trusting a stranger that you've never met before to come in and then sell through your cash register. Now, what we're doing at Few and Far is looking to redesign. So the business logic goes where it belongs, which is in the smart contract of the creator, where they have full control and ownership of that contract without then having to worry about a third-party marketplace or company coming in and not honoring the royalties which they were expecting and the revenues that they were generating.
Gotcha. So I think I really love, you know, we're here to solve problems for creators. You're building the infrastructure just to protect those rights and the economic, you know, benefits that we're really here to help creators with.
Yeah, so what we've seen in the generation one of NFTs been a lot of PFP projects, very much native within the crypto trader environment and world, and they've been trading JPEGs of monkeys, and everything's been great to demonstrate the technology, but it then doesn't scale to the millions and millions of users that we want to get on board. And that's where we're seeing Fortune 500 brands and companies that are looking to build and market and engage with huge communities, plus also generate from secondary revenues that they can sell through trading digital collectibles, and it becomes a revenue stream. And that is the business logic that's going to determine Fortune 500 brands like Disney, Starbucks, to then want to enter the Web3 space. And the two questions they're going to ask is it easy for my millions of customers and users to adopt, or is it going to be a nightmare to try and onboard these users and promote this campaign? And second of all, what's in it for us as a publicly traded company, and how much revenues are we going to make from this? And so redesigning the problem, we need to solve those two issues before we can really scale this as an industry.
Gotcha. It's super interesting. So maybe talking a little bit about media powerhouses. I think, Daryl, you've had a lot of experiences. I'm sure some in the audience have even seen a lot of the work that you've helped to produce and create. And so can you tell us a little bit about how you see, you know, culture and money coming together to bring about the next billion users? How is what you're building speaking to the average person on the street?
That's a great question. So the biggest thing to me is right now there's a lot of gatekeepers and barriers to the people who are making the greatest entertainment of our generation. Like, for 30,000 years, we've used stories to convey the most important elements of humanity. And the way that we tell stories today, one of the most visual mediums is in film and television. And so for me, the idea that we can create communities who can connect directly with those creators and participate in the creative process, that's a really exciting thing. And so, I think a lot of the problems that we have, Chris spoke to this, is the usability of blockchain. There's such a fall off right now. But if we bring people in and we explain to them the value that they get from the blockchain, if they can understand that they can participate in something that they already care about, then we're going to help onboard millions of people in a much more efficient and natural way. So by creating an opportunity for you to engage with the creator of your favorite TV show or of a movie, you can literally buy a behind-the-scenes pass where you can do Q&As with the cast and crew. You can get updates from set. You can participate in the creative process of these things that allows you to engage in a completely new way that is very much, you know, centered around the Web3 ethos. And we see so many of these creators who don't necessarily participate in the royalties, even of the shows that are created. Sometimes you can create a billion-dollar franchise and make a few hundred thousand dollars. But if we bring in the fans, we can say, hey, you know what? You can connect directly with this creator, and then you can share in that value system back and forth. So to me, the average person, if we can figure out a way to bring them into something that they already want to do, and something that they want to engage with, whether that's film and television, whether that's, you know, a physical collectible with an on-chain proof of authenticity or through ticketing, there's a lot of values that we can bring in, and we can bring them in a way that's very natural, as opposed to, you know, the friction process of like creating a MetaMask wallet and figuring out how to put money into it.
Gotcha. Okay, so I'm Joe on the street. I just logged onto the Kino website for the first time. Can you talk me through some of the projects that you're working on? Like, what am I going to get excited about?
Yeah, so we're going to do an official announcement of our movies in a couple of months. So we haven't actually launched any of our films yet. But we have spent the last year really building in partnerships with some of the most amazing creators. And I've been very fortunate with my community in film and television to be mentored by some fantastic individuals. And so what we did is I went and found creators who had created hundreds of millions and billions of dollars collectively for these other industries. And they go to one of the big six. And I said, hey, I'd love to help you market your film from the very beginning. I'd love to bring you like fans in from the beginning. And so we have a lineup of 10 films that we're going to launch starting in a couple of months, actually.
Gotcha. I'm super excited for that. Looking forward to that. Cool. So one of the favorite things I like to talk about, video games. I'm addicted to it, spend way too much money on it. So Hugo, you are the reason why my girlfriend has problems with me. Can you help me understand, you know, some of the problems that you're helping to solve for players and the huge mobile gaming ecosystem at the moment?
Sure. So I think at the moment, there are two big problems with the mobile gaming ecosystem. One is for the mobile game studios, and then one is for the players. For the mobile game studios, it's actually a Web 2 problem and a Web 3 problem. It's super, super hard at the moment to build a profitable mobile game. And I think that's due to the market. Advertisers don't want to advertise as much. But actually, I think that's a huge opportunity just in general for Web 3 and Web 3 product. And I think that's where we will really onboard a lot of people when we can create a Web3 product which is better than the Web2 incumbent. So I think what we're doing, we're not competing with other Web3 products. We're competing with the Web2 ones with great UX, great UI. So I think that's a great opportunity at the moment to kind of seamlessly onboard people and onboard mobile game studios. So with our Unity SDK, we can kind of onboard these mobile game studios really, really quickly within a few minutes and give these mobile game studios another line of monetization. And then on the other side, so the players, and I think this is a problem that players aren't overly aware of or aware that it can be different. Currently, they're being monetized super, super aggressively. And it's kind of a walled garden at the moment, the Web2 mobile game ecosystem. So you've got Apple and Google, and you've got all of these ad providers that aggressively monetize, and the users, the players, never get anything back for it. But we've found that actually, if you do give something back, or you can say, right, continue to play our game for a bit longer, and you'll get an NFT, although actually using the word NFT kind of meant the conversions went down massively, so you call it collectibles and avatars. That actually made people stick around for way longer and actually consume more ads, have a higher long-term value, LTV, and the retention stats for kind of day seven went up 100%. So these are all really great kind of in-game stats that went up because the player was more rewarded and more happy, and just things like ratings go up. I think we need to speak in the language of the mass market and make product that is better than the Web2 incumbents.
Gotcha. So I really like that framing that you said, right? Like, we're not trying to create the best Web3 experience. We're not competing with other Web3 players. We're just creating a better experience, full stop. And that experience is going to bring everyone on board if it's objectively, the thing that users want. And maybe I'd love to dig into that a little bit more. You talked about, framing as collectibles, as rewards. Can you talk me through how some of those rewards and kind of collectible dynamics have emerged in some of the games that you've been helping develop, how users have been particularly receptive to certain things?
So one thing that's worked really well is fractionalized prizes or fractionalized NFTs. So say you're in one of our games, Raft Life, and you get the bottom half of it's the example everyone uses, a sword. So the bottom half of a sword, and then we say, okay, you need to play our other game and search around for the top half of the sword. When you get both, then you can merge them together, and that's your your new NFT, your new collectible, and you can use that. And hopefully in time, we want that to be a real social element. So I've got the bottom half, you've got the top half, I'll give you 300 coins for it, and we kind of swap like that.
Gotcha. I think we were joking backstage that that sounded a little bit like the McDonald's Monopoly game. Yeah. That I never won.
I don't think anyone ever does.
Or maybe I just didn't have enough friends. Okay, great. So, Oleg, you know, I think what you've done with Setcoin has been, you know, truly remarkable. Hundreds of millions of users really on board and using the product, especially given the background, you know, you guys were building in the Web2 space and transitioned over to Web3. So, As you made that transition, I think you have a really unique perspective about what works to onboard people from Web2 to Web3. Could you maybe talk through some of the lessons that you might have observed that might be helpful for some of the builders, founders, even investors in the room?
Sure, it would be a pleasure. Very good question, because as I mentioned in my presentation, we've been looking at blockchain from 2014, but actually when we started the migration and we started putting specifics into the launch, we realized how sort of complicated and how diverse the opinions were, what was the role of Web3 and how we should be playing in it. So the framework that we ultimately developed was, you really need to think about your use case, not from technology perspective, but from the user perspective. And very frequently we don't talk about it because we, as a business, you normally have a use case, but if you kind of lift yourself off and just hearing this gentleman speak, you know, you need to think about mass market need and the problem that you are solving. And once you have definition of that problem and there is an ownership element in it, then you actually have a very, very good and interesting use case that you can take into Web3. In our case, it was, we already for 7 years were paying people for their movement with sweat coins that were centralized. They existed in our blockchain called Postgres SQL database. They could only be used inside our app. So we're terribly suboptimal. And we wanted to pay users with real blockchain, you know, based currency. And users really gagged for it. They wanted it. They demanded it. And we now know that it is a humongous benefit for us and for them when we were able to start delivering it. So first, use case. Second thing is, and gentlemen here have already referred to it, all of them, is UI UX. It is not good enough to put a 24-word seed phrase, massive red banner on top of it. If you lose this, you're screwed, and then not even add a copy button underneath it, because for the next hundreds of millions of users, this is not the experience that they will cope with. And a lot of them are burned. Like a lot of our users, they already had experience, we had interviews, experience of starting wallets, and just simply couldn't go through the onboarding process. They just balked and they said, this is too complicated, this is too scary, the words were not understandable, so I just can't engage with this. So you need to think about it from first principles. How would I build this for my mom, for my grandma? And once they understand, then you're onto something. And the third thing, and I think that this is probably the most controversial, is if we are thinking about bringing the next billion people, we need to make sure that their entry is either free or extremely, extremely, extremely low value required from them. Because there are no whales left who are not engaged. The average person in all around the world is not going to have more than 10 to 20 bucks to their soul at any moment of time. $8 transaction on Ethereum is probably going to wipe, you know, kind of the balance of any person that is out there waiting to jump into Web3. So we really need to think hard how to remove these barriers, how to make UX great, how to make it free for them, educate them, and then they will engage and they'll add value.
Cool. No, Oleg, thank you so much for that. I think we got pretty good reception to that view. I actually love to dig a little bit deeper into what you just said. I know you mentioned a couple of very specific examples, but have there been other examples, maybe on the kind of UX or feature set, where once you launched it for you, it immediately became clear that this made a ton of sense, or it became clear that this did not make a ton of sense, and you know, you moved away from that?
Hmm. Oh, you know what? I'm going to talk to my biggest bugbear right now, like, you know, the thing that we're solving. It's a swap experience. Because swap experience, special indexes, is you choose the asset that you have, and then you choose the asset that you want to get in return. It is insane user experience. I mean, honestly, this is like going to 7-Eleven and declaring at the entrance, I've got $56.97. What can I get for it? Nobody shops like this. I mean, humans really do not spend money in this way, ever, with exception of the swap functionality. How the hell did we end up in this situation, right? When you walk into 7-Eleven, you think two milks, one, you know, bread, and I don't know, whatever, crate of beer. So the swap exchange and the trading should be exactly like that. You need to choose what you want. You need to choose the amount that you want. And then you choose how you're going to pay for it. And not in any other way. And this is something that is actually a massive barrier to a lot of people, because they just don't understand why they need to be thinking in a completely different way from their everyday experience. So this is just one example, and the reason why I mention is because we're working through this right now, and the experience of 7-Eleven is that principle that we use, you know, kind of, how do you design a experience to solve specific problem, as opposed to how do I design an experience around the query, which is basically what happens right now with the typical UX of the swap.
Yeah, I think it makes a lot of sense. You know, the average person here is very used to some of the more trading-oriented kind of UX that might not be for the average person. Right, Chris?
Can I just add, one thing? So what's really interesting with what Oleg and Sweatcoin and Hugo and Playamber are doing is that they are thinking about it very differently than what we've seen in this first generation of play-to-earn gaming. And that's been very much focused on not an existing community or user base, and it's been building a game, a DeFi'd version of a game for crypto enthusiasts that have been trading crypto probably for many years. And then that turned into the farming and the yield farming and everything else. Whereas Oleg and Hugo are approaching it with their users and their millions and millions of users in mind. And so it's a very different product thought process in building it that way around versus building it for them, the crypto natives. So it's really interesting to see a very different breed of an approach to Web3 and gamification, which also is important to think about the value, because if you've just got a game which is just giving out tokens and there's no value creation, then it's a short-term opportunity, right? It's not sustainable. Where it's great to see what Sweatcoin's doing in the value creation of that, and with Playamber, that is put forward and center in the business model.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So maybe I think on that note, it would be amazing to get everyone's views here on, you know, you guys have been building for a long while. There have been tons of consumer founders in the space who have been trying to think about, you know, what are some of the best practices for customer discovery specifically. Given your backgrounds, love to see if anyone has any tips or any frameworks or any stories about how they've stumbled upon or kind of refine pain points in the customer discovery process.
Yeah, for us, where it started going really well for Playamber was actually when we, I suppose, stopped trying to shoehorn Web3 into everything and just went back, I think Oleg said it earlier, back to what the user wants. And we're lucky enough to have users so we could actually just test and iterate. So effectively see what works with data.
You know, we run the whole raft of things, and starting from qualitative discovery where you go and you interview people and you ask them questions. Like, you know, for example, when we started development of our Web3 product, the first thing we've done, we've segmented our users and we went and we've spoken to every demographic because we were mildly concerned that, you know, for example, roughly one third of our Sweetcoin users are women at, you know, 45 plus. And our concern was, you know, kind of, do they care about crypto? Do they want to even kind of engage in it? Is there maybe a hangover from the Silk Road days where they think that this is something that is about drugs and there is some kind of negativity there? So we eliminated this because through interviews, we very quickly realized that everyone is very interested in the space. They want to engage, but they have these two barriers, as I've described. They couldn't deal with onboarding, and they felt that it would be too expensive for them to engage because basically the way they were talking about it is, I'm going to have to pay hundreds and hundreds of dollars to educate myself. And the probability of me losing this money is incredibly high because there is no day passes without a headline. 600 million got drained from Ronin, 300 million got drained from Wormhole. And the way people perceive it is they're not reading Wormhole or Ronin. They think that if they put money into this space, it will be them that will lose it. So we eliminated that concern. After that, what we've done is we've done a proper kind of testing. We've done 35,000 users. We put them to a partner's product that, you know, kind of was very interesting for them. And we, you know, our only condition was they share aggregated data on these users' behavior so that we could understand when users engage into Web3, when they get tokens, what happens then? How do they behave? Do they pull the card out or, you know, kind of do they just simply cash out? And we learned that actually our users, you know, they tread very carefully, but once they familiarize themselves, they are becoming quite a significant trader. Not whales, but they trade in hundreds of dollars, which is, you know, for a lot of them, probably a substantial amount of money. Not for people probably sitting here, but for them it is. So we do this qualitative, then we do proper kind of testing. And then the last thing that we always do is A-B testing, because no matter how hard you work, typically you end up having, you know, kind of uncertainties around the nuances of that product. Like, how do you call the stuff? Do you call it NFT or do you call it collectible? And once you have users, as Hugo does, you can actually put A, NFT, B, collectibles, and you can compare, and then you kind of go, oh my God, this is performing like 10x better. So it's qualitative discovery, then it's sort of partnership and sort of digging in a very, very cheap way, doing MVP with a partner, and the third one is AB.
Gotcha, amazing. Daryl, I think you had a point.
Yeah, we've talked a lot about just creating product and the usability, feasibility, viability, and value. And we've talked a lot about the usability being difficult and then the value in that education layer. But I think you brought up an interesting point, which is also around trust, especially in this space. So we need to make sure that we're communicating in a way that does make it easier for everyone. And we are not Web 2 or Web 3 individuals. We're human beings. And so when I put this in front of my mom, it needs to be easier. We found in our like product discovery that as we were putting people through a checkout process, if they had to create a wallet and go through all of the friction at the beginning, it was very difficult to even make a sale. But if my mom could get on and just check out with her credit card or you know, Apple Pay the normal way, she's infinitely more likely to convert to blockchain after the fact when we've explained the value. And so I think if we're thinking about this as human beings, just having the user empathy, it's what made Apple Apple. And I think it's what Web3 desperately needs, because we come in and for a while I think we had this idea that the difficulty made it exclusive, and it probably led to a lot of bad choices in our UX in general.
And I'll just lead on from that. I think Web3 have been looking at the metrics wrong and looking at this TLV as everything. That's been the main holy grail of whether a project's successful or not, and it isn't applicable when you're building a mass market infrastructure and tools. And something we really like about Near is they have a different perspective and a different viewpoint on what should be the key metrics to look for in a successful infrastructure. And that is more monthly active accounts, active users. And that's going to get the mass market in more excited and brands coming into the space, because they want to be able to engage and reach and sell to these millions and millions of users who are using the network invisibly behind the scenes.
Thank you so much. I think that's about us for time, but I really love that we were talking about, you know, abstraction of onboarding, abstraction of UX, and really sweating the small stuff when it comes to how we talk about gaming, consumer, and blockchain. So thank you very much for the speakers here today. If you could have a round of applause for them. Thank you again.
Thank you.
And thank you for moderating.